Okay, let's start. So, hi, I'm Paweł Bartkiewicz. Oh, sorry, hi. I was meant to show you something, but let's... Okay. I think it should be fine. Maybe. Is it better now? I'm not sure.
Okay.
Okay, so yeah, so I'm Paweł Bartkiewicz. I'm with Scala for almost 3 years now. And today I'd like to talk about JQ, which is a tool for processing JSON. And because I don't like preparing presentations, and because this is mostly about programming language, I decided to do it take a more practical approach. Instead of showing you just some slides, we'll do some live coding, which is a bit scary, but we'll see. So about me, as I said, my email is here, my work email at least. If you really want my private email, you can get it from GitHub, like all the recruiters do. And I have a Twitter account, but I don't really use it, so I don't know if it really matters at all. Okay, so let's start. So basic indexing. Who has heard about JQ or used it already, seen it used? Okay. Have you ever tried to write any bigger scripts with JQ or just
define?
Like, were they only as just some simple filters or you know, one-liners or scripts which you put in a file and split into multiple lines and not function and so on? No, not really. Okay. Many people use JQ because it's a very nice tool for processing JSON. Like, let's try downloading some JSON. I guess I should probably make this bigger too. It's small, still quite small. Okay, maybe. As an example, we will use Pang API, which is a collection of data which Brewdog, a Scottish brewery, released some time ago, a few years ago, as open source. And someone made it into a REST API, which serves JSON, so this is quite nice for demonstrating some complex JSON documents, relatively complex. So we'll download this. We'll download a list of beers. Maybe it's a bit too large. Okay, so let's download. Yeah, we have some list of beers. And as you can see, like usually most servers, you can compacted JSON without any white space, you know, without any imitation and so on, which is quite hard to do for humans. So of course there are many and JQ can be used as one. You can simply pass the JSON file to JQ on the standard input. And, well, maybe I will probably be through less. I did something wrong? No? Okay, well, doesn't matter. Like you can see, it's pretty printed. Like it is split into multiple lines. It has indentation. It has nice colors and so on. So this is how people quite often use JQ, just as a pretty printer for JSON. However, well, let's maybe swap this. You can of course invoke this way, like it's standard, like shell usage. So we process the Beers JSON file through JQ, and by default JQ doesn't filter the input in any way, so it just pretty prints it and shows all of it. This invocation of JQ, I hope you can see it. Like it's very low on the screen, so maybe I guess yeah. Okay. So this invocation of JQ is the same as passing it a filter, which consists of a dot, and a dot in JQ means whole document. Well, more or less, like whole input. So this is the same. We'll put it in single quotes just to be safe, because we'll create some more interesting filters in a minute. So this invocation just takes whole input and outputs it untouched. However, when we take a look at this file, we can see it's an array. Like we can see it here. It's an array of some objects, and these objects have some key value pairs, like ID, name, tagline, first root, and so on. So let's try to first we have to index the array. Let's take the first object in the array. We can see it's Buzz, which was a light, crisp, and bitter IPA. Now we can take just the name key of this object, and we see it's Buzz. Like we can also take, for example, food pairing. Nice. We can take first element of the food pairing array. Of course, it works. Like it's all simple stuff. It's like it's kind of like XPath, but this is for JSON, not for XML. Okay, let's go back to the slides, table of contents. Yeah. So this was basic indexing. Like you can put some key after the dot, and it will take it will take this key from the object and output only that. However, we can combine multiple filters by using a pipe operator, which is very, very similar to standard shell pipe operators, like in Bash or most other shells. So we can, for example, we can take again the first element of the array, and we can put it through another filter, which takes the name of the object, which is the same as we did before. This equivalent. Where it gets more interesting is when you omit the index. You will get all names of all beers, and this is still quite simple stuff. And now we can, for example, we can take food pairing again, and we can take first food pairing of every beer. Easy. Okay. So that's the basic usage of JQ. JQ, because it's JQ is about processing JSON, the types which it supports are the same as in JSON. So it supports scalars and non-scalars, and scalars consists of numbers, strings, and booleans. Non-scalars consists of arrays and objects, just like in JSON. And an important thing is that strings in JQ aren't equal to numbers. Like the equality operator in JQ is really the same as the triple equality operator in JavaScript. It doesn't try to compare different types.
Is there a different operator to coerce, like
Not really. That's a good question. Like for example, here, let's take a value which is a number, okay? Like something maybe. IBU, so the bitterness of the beer. So let's take IBU and let's compare it to 60. It's true. Let's compare it to 60 as a string. It's false. However, you can use two string filter and it will convert the IBU value to a string, and now we can compare it with against a string. And of course, we can do the same with a string. We can convert it to a number, and it will also work. But as far as I know, there is no operator which would do this for us automatically. And another important thing is that true in JQ, when you use it in conditions or wherever JQ expects a boolean, it doesn't treat one as a true value. Treat zero as a false value. The only values which it considers false are zero and null. False and null, of course. False and null. So that's about the types. I don't want to go into all the details because we have limited time, and I would like to just show you like the big picture and why JQ could be useful for you. So array and object constructors. So as we've seen, we can filter some JSON, and that's fine. But let's say we want to output some different JSON, like structure it differently. So let's say we want to take name of every beer and bitterness of it. Like here's name, here's bitterness. So we can combine them, for example, into one array. Let's start with name, IBU. That's the scary part of live coding. I will have to explain this. So here we have to first extract all the objects from the top level array, and then for each object we take its name, its IBU value, and we construct an array out of them. So as we can see, we have many arrays. Each array consists of a name as the first element, so index 0, and some bitterness. We can do the same with objects. We can create objects with some keys. So here we have we create objects which have name and IBU. And of course we can rename the keys. That is fine. An interesting tip is that there's a shorthand for this. You can just if you omit the key and just put some name, like some identifier, JQ will treat it the same as name IBU. It's the same. So it's a shorthand. And as you've probably noticed, we don't need to put double quotes like in JSON, unlike in JSON. If the identifier is a simple one without any special characters, we can omit them. But we can of course also I deleted the dots accidentally. So we can of course include the double quotes as well. It doesn't matter. So here's how you can construct documents.
And how do you put those objects into an array?
Because now you have objects which are like separate JSON documents. Yeah, that's a good question. I will come to that in a second. I will just change my prompt so it's easier to. Yeah. Okay. So and of course we can make it a bit more complex. For example, we can. Add foot first foot pairing of every beer. And it works. Now, if you want to put it into an array, that's a bit tricky in this case because there is a filter which takes all the input and wraps it into an array, but in this case there is a simple, like easier or more elegant solution, which I would like to talk in a minute. I would just like to show you. Okay, well, I guess we can swap them. So there is map filter. So let's delete all of these and start from scratch. So we can use the map filter to map every element of the array. For example, here. So and we should be able to omit this part because like this is completely redundant because it just outputs the whole input. So of course we can omit this. And if you compare this to this, like here we have like just a bunch of strings with no JSON structure. And if we do this, it actually maps each element of the array and puts the result back into an array because we don't touch the array. So it's very, very, very similar to map functions in many programming languages. I think by now most of them have similar functions. Maybe a side note, if you're really, really interested in this, there's a parameter which makes the output and input, which okay, maybe my version doesn't support it, but I'm pretty sure there is an option which allows you to use the standard JSON document separators. So before each JSON document, there is a record separator character inserted, and after each object, there is a new line of it character. Okay. So it's yes.
Can you dump output into the file?
Yeah, of course. That's like, you know, that depends on the shell which you use. In my case, my shell is Bash in this case. But yeah, of course we can dump it into a file, and this is using the standard Bash operator of.
Is it going to be automatically saved as a JSON file, or it's just text file? Or
well, it's JSON. No. It is a text file, but it should be like JSON. I guess you. Well, I'm not sure what you're.
No, it's like on the beginning, you just kind of like yeah. It's fine. You're loading that bs.json, yeah? So that means like JSON file.
Yeah. I can. Sorry, I forgot the extension. Okay. Like I can add the extension, of course. Like it doesn't matter in Unix-like systems. It doesn't really matter most of the time.
Just one more question.
Yeah.
Can you compare the print JSON objects like beers and smoothies or something like that? Do this comparison?
Yeah. I will. Maybe I will do it with something simpler. So, let's try comparing arrays. True. False. False. Objects. They should work as well. Because everything is in JQ is a value, and there are no references, so we can just compare them, and it will of course compare it by value. Yeah, it's true, and if we change a key, it's false. If we change a value, it's false as well.
What about nested arrays? Can you search nested arrays?
Yes. I will probably talk about that later. Because I would like to cover some basics first, like the very basics, because most people here haven't used JQ, so I would like to just show the basics. So let's go back to our example with map name. So as you can see, we can map the names. We can also map IBUs. And let's say we want to add 1,000 to all values because we want to make our beers unnaturally bitter. So you can put any filters here. An interesting thing is that in JQ, every expression is a filter, and I will come back to this later when we introduce functions. Spoilers. Everything is a filter, and everything is passed as a thunk. So we'll come back to that. Okay, let's go back to the basics. Formatters are another interesting thing in JQ. You can, instead of using that beers JSON file, I will just use some. Simpler values. So we can use formatters which have the form of the at sign and then name of the formatter. Like in this example, it's base64, and JQ will transform it according to the formatter. And we can then decode it. It's base 60. Sorry, I haven't used it in a while, but I'm pretty sure it's. I should base 64. Yeah, it's base 64D. I'm not sure why it's not working. I guess I have installed some old version of JQ on this computer, but it should work in a new version. We can also, for example, maybe I will show you the list simply. So we can use HTML formatter, for example, which will escape some symbols, some characters, according to HTML spec. We can use URI, which will use the percent sign encoding. CSV is very handy. Like I don't know about you, but I've worked with Spark quite a lot over the past year, and there was a lot of CSV files and also some JSON, and converting between CSV and JSON is quite handy. And JQ, like I don't think current version of JQ can convert from CSV to JSON yet, but at least it can format JSON as CSV. So here we have one we have an array of three elements encoded as CSV, so it just puts commas between these elements, and as you can see, it wrapped the whole thing in double quotes. That's because by default JQ always outputs valid JSON documents, but we can change this with the -r option, and it will output raw strings, no JSON text. So we can add r, and yeah, we have a CSV like file. Also, the option which I've been using for some time here, minus n, is just because I'm not using an input file. I'm just putting the input inside, like the filter, hard coding it. So that's why I'm using it. Okay, so let's go back to our beers.json file, and here let's take name and IBU again. Now let's encode it as CSV. Yeah, so as you can see, and minus R. Okay, yeah. So it looks like valid CSV. If there is a double quote inside any of the values, then JQ will escape it, and as you can see, it always quotes strings when it's necessary. So it's fine. Okay, so enough about formatters, because you can always check the manual and see what formatters are currently supported. Like there's also TSV, there is SH, which is a pretty interesting formatter which escapes strings so that they are safe for POSIX shells. Yeah, back to the topic. Another interesting feature of JQ are regular expressions. Like here we have an example. So match is another filter which takes like the regular expressions and some flags, and let's try to let's copy it and try it in the shell. JQ minus N. Okay, so yeah. So as you can see, it found a match, of course, because like as we can see, this regular expression is very simple, and this input is also like the whole input matches this expression. So it found this expression at offset 0, it has length 10, the whole string is here, and if you look here, I've used a capture group. Like if you don't know what capture groups in regular expressions are, I guess you should learn about them, because they're pretty useful. And it captured this this 42 as a separate like group, and we have offset and length as well. So let's add some. What happened? Let's add some more numbers here. Let's change this expression to capture numbers followed by space. And I guess we don't need this then. So, okay, I don't know why this doesn't work. Okay, maybe. Like I think it should. Oh, yeah, I.
Space before plus, so you should have plus space.
Plus space.
After the
you mean here?
Yeah, no space.
Like I think what's wrong here is that what version of JQ is this? I should have checked this on this computer. 1.5.1, and what version is the newest one? 1.6. Like I guess maybe my version doesn't support it. Well, anyway, like The idea, you saw the idea, you can use regular expressions and extract some useful info from that, and then you can quite easily take, for example, captures zero string. Like, of course, this example is not very practical, but if you need to do some complex processing if you have some complex regular expressions and need to do some processing on the capture groups and then so on, then I think JQ is quite nice. And another interesting feature of JQ option is that you can read raw strings. You don't have to use JSON. So, for example, let's output some string like just as a simple string without any JSON formatting. We can now process that with JQ. And I will add this option here. Yeah, so you can also use JQ for processing raw text, not only JSON, if you want. Like, I guess if you know JQ well enough, it might be more like convenient than using grep or sed.
So if you run the z up in the square brackets, that's the search for entire nested array, yeah?
It's
a nested array, so.
But in what here?
There's only one item, so that's.
I can add more. Like this. Capture groups here. What I was trying to do earlier was repeating whole capture group, but for some reason, I guess maybe it's not supported in this version. I was pretty sure it was supported, but maybe I confused it with some other implementation of regular expressions because there are so many of them. But these are mainly pair compatible regular expressions. So the thing which is used by most languages. Okay, so back to the presentation. Okay, so these are all the like basic, maybe not all the, but these are the some of the basic filters you can use in JQ. And as you saw, you can compose them by using pipe. And this is fine for 99% of use cases, probably. Like I've been using JQ this way a lot over the last few years because I've been working with REST APIs, which were returning JSON files. Well, JSON nowadays is used like almost everywhere. It's like XML 20 years ago, or maybe 15 years ago. So this use is quite nice. However, it turns out that JQ is a real programming language, a functional programming language. It's not limited to simple filters. So, for example, we have variables, and variables aren't that interesting, but they may be helpful sometimes. Like we can define variable 13, and now we can use it for example like this. So of course this is completely useless. To be honest, it's kind of hard to find an example where you do have to use variables because JQ is a functional language and usually can express most things by piping outputs from one function to another and so on. And yeah, one thing which I forgot to mention is that each filter takes like a single input and has a single output, like all filters in JQ. But as we saw with match, for example, here, or earlier with map, where is map? Map, yeah. So here, for example, it took the whole document as the input, but it also took an argument, which was the function which we ran on every element of the array. So all filters in JQ have a single input, single output, and they can have some arguments, some parameters. Like this map only has one, but match had two arguments, and you separate arguments with semicolons. So it's quite hard to find a good example of variables. So I took one from the documentation of JQ. So here we can see, like, if we have some I forgot JSON itself. Well, if we have two JSON objects, or maybe one, a map from some names to real names, and array of posts, it would be hard to, if you wanted to map those posts and map the names to real names, it would be hard to do it without defining a temporary variable, well, not temporary, but a variable here, to be able to refer to, sorry for forgetting this JSON example. I think it was somewhere here. Variable, maybe real name. Yeah, okay, so here is the... So here's the example. We have an array of posts, and we have an object which maps some nicks to real names. And if you want to take these posts and map the author of each to the real name of the author, like here, we need to use the temporary variable. But it is quite rare, and I think I've only had to use variables in JQ a few times so far. But they are there if you need them. However, there is one interesting usage of variables. It's destructuring. You can take a JSON document or like some value, and destructure it and assign the destructured values to some variables, like we see here. So let's copy it. And now let's, I don't know, maybe A B. Okay, yeah. So it matched the first two elements of the array and assigned them to variables A and B, and then we created an object with these variables. Of course, we can name name them differently, like first, second, and here the shorthand where you omit the key. Well, just a tip. And it works with some nested documents as well, like. Nope. Oh yeah. yeah. So let's call this foo, and let's call this bar, and let's assign foo to C and bar to. Well, and the contents of bar to ANP. Yeah, so it worked. So it's quite powerful and probably more useful than simple variables. OK, and now the interesting part. Functions. You can define functions in JQ. A very simple example is an increment function. JQ def, it's like in Scala, increment. And as I said, each function by default takes one like one input and one and has one output. Like they all do this, but you can add some parameters. So the input is the dot, of course, always. Like it's represented by the dot. And the output is whatever value is last. Like the last expression is always the output of the function. So here we have an increment function, and now we can take some number, let's say 13, and pipe it to this function, increment, and it added one. Yeah, we can also, like, let's say we want to increment it by some number. So, well, let's say it's add, not increment. So now we would, like, let's say we want to add 100. So here's how we can define functions in the queue. A very important thing is that all parameters in JQ are passed as thanks, so by name. So if you use the parameter multiple times inside the function body, it will be evaluated multiple times as well. And if you want to avoid that, you can assign the output of this parameter, like its value, to some variable, and use this variable instead, because variables are like values. And now, if we use m twice here, we only evaluate n once when we assign it to the variable. So this won't work because this is sorry? Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's true. But that's not all. Like, I also need to enclose this. Yeah, I like this, I guess. Uh, Okay, maybe let's check an example, which I took from the from JQ itself. No, this is not a good example. yeah, so here we have an example. I wrote some function like some time ago, which converted human readable strings to ANSI color codes, and here we can see that it is possible to define functions with like multiple lines in the body, and this is how I always do it. And it is a bit difficult when I do it in the shell as a one-liner. Okay, let's go back to this later if we have any time left. Because that was like I don't think it matters for most. Like if I don't think you would ever encounter this, but I just wanted to mention that in case you need to pass some argument by value, you can use the variable to like cache it, memoize it. However, you can use a shorthand, and this should work. Like, let's go back to the. Original example, like we have add m, and we want to let's call it double m. So yeah, so here if we call this function. Oh yeah. Yeah. So as you can see here, we added the parameter twice, and we ignored the input, and the argument 50 wasn't evaluated twice. But you have to trust me on this, because like I could find an example which would show. But I don't think I will waste your time here. I just wanted to mention this, like, quickly to warn you about this. Okay, let's go back. Sorry. So we have this example of map, and this is an interesting example because this is how the map function, which I introduced earlier, actually is implemented in JQ. So. It constructs an array where each element of this array is an element of the input array piped through the f function, which you pass as the parameter. So most functions in JQ, most built-in functions in JQ. Are defined like in JQ itself this way. I have an example of passing by value here. I forgot about this. Yeah. So here you can see an example where we're evaluating f twice would be bad because you potentially bad. Okay, this is getting a bit chaotic. Anyway, we can also use recursion, and JQ optimizes away tail recursion. If your function returns a single value, it will be. It won't even use any additional memory. So here you can see how the while function, which I haven't mentioned before, is implemented in JQ. So it takes two arguments, condition and update, and it as long as the condition is true, it runs the update function on its previous output. So, for example, JQN 10 while it is smaller than 10, let's double it. Yeah, so here's how we would use it. And as you can see, it's defined in JQ itself, so quite interesting. And you can create generators. Okay, no example here, but I can show you. Like most languages here now, but I don't know most, but for example, Python has generators as well. You can define a function which takes. Okay, this will be quite complex, and I don't think you need to know this. So maybe let's skip it. But you can define generators. If you want to know more about this, you can always check the manual, and I will link some references at the end. Reduce is maybe more interesting because it implements recursion in a nice way. It's like reducing Scala, for example, or fold left maybe. Is a better example. So we can take, let's say we take some array of numbers, and we reduce it. We use zero as the initial value, and we I forgot this. Reduce as x, for example. So we have to define a variable which will hold the element currently being processed. So we take a zero as an initial value, and then we add each number and accumulate the result.
The definition is supposed to be on the end
of
the plan.
Oh.
AS.
Yeah. I forgot this part. So yeah, so the syntax is reduce, here is what you want to reduce, and then as item, and so on. Like you can see, I don't use the more advanced features of JQ so often, and I don't know them by heart. I always look up them in my manual. But it happened a few times that I wanted to write some more complex script for processing some, for example, some logs, log files. And I wanted to do it on some server because which contained those logs, because those log files were huge and downloading them wasn't feasible, or maybe for legal reasons I shouldn't do that. And there was some ancient version of Python, like 2.6 I think, and there was also Perl. But JQ turned out to be the most convenient tool to do that. So it's not very often that I use JQ in such an advanced way, but it does happen from time to time. And I'm pretty sure if I spend more time using it. Like if I didn't knew set and grep and many other tools, I would probably use JQ more for stuff. So anyway, Yeah, some examples. Like here's a function which parts a string with space, well, with some character, like character C, up to n characters. So let's try this function. Like, okay, let's paste this into a .jq file in my home directory. .jq file. And if we do that now, if I run jq, I can use this function because it's another version mismatch thing. Okay, let's do this in this way. Include. Okay, maybe not. Maybe this way. Pad left. And let's use this. JQ. Yeah. Oh, okay. Why is this not working? Well, in theory, if I put some function definitions in .jq file in my home directory, jq should read those on each invocation and they should be available here, but I don't know, I guess I made some simple mistake somewhere here and that's why it doesn't work. Okay, well, you have to trust me on this. But it's possible. Or you can check it in the manual. I think it's somewhere here. Yeah. Yeah, if home JQ is a file, it's sourced into the main program. I'm not sure why this is not working. I guess this is an old version of JQ. That's why. Which I didn't expect because this is a freshly installed system. Okay, so maybe let's end here. So the references which I promised, there is the JQ manual which I have shown you a few times, and there is also a JQ language description, which is an interesting document which describes the design behind JQ, how it works internally. It's quite interesting, and I think it's an interesting functional language, which isn't like. Usually when we talk about functional programming, we think about Haskell, for example. Nowadays we use a lot of category theory and so on. Sometimes some people think about Lisp, for example. But as we can see, even as such a simple language as JQ, can be also a functional language which is quite useful and lets us do some useful things very quickly. Like I don't think there's any tool which lets you process JSON faster. And of course the API which I used to download the JSON file. Like I was going to do some processing on that file, like more complex one, but I got driven away like from that. Sorry. Okay. So any questions, maybe?
So if you say about these functions, we can use it inside maps.
Yeah. Like everything in JQ, which is in the value, like a JSON value, is a function. So you can use those functions. Like if you define a function, let's say def foo times 10, and call it on like put some value through it. Like what you do here is almost like putting this function body inside here. And if you, I can show you how it can be used. Yes. So you can use the function inside map, like as the map argument.
And if there was an example, this appears. So you can use map, of course, for each element of this file. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So let's go back to this. So we have an array, a map. So let's define a function. For example, let's add bitterness. Now we can use this function instead. Add bitterness. Def. IBU. Yeah.
Okay.
So we can use this. Okay, and I think that's all. And maybe one more thing which is important is that, like we've already seen it, but an array of multiple elements is not the same as multiple elements like outside the array in JQ. Because as you can see here, we had to use map to map each element, but if we instead did this, like we would process each element, like each element of the array as a separate JSON document, and JQ would output every resulting JSON document separately. I think that's all. Any more questions?
Yeah.
Is this used in applications, like in code, or it's more for manual reading or testing data?
It's like I've seen it used in some scripts, for example, in CI pipelines by other people. Personally, I usually use it to do some manual processing of JSON files, like if I need to explore some data or just pretty print it. It's quite useful in scripts. I have written some scripts which used JQ and did some useful stuff like I mentioned before, processing log files was one example.
So I have one place where we have an external application. It output logs in JSON format, but mm-hmm. we have our internal log format. So mm-hmm. we wrapped the whole application in a start script that pipes the whole output through JQ to produce our format.
Yeah, yeah.
So this runs in production, like as a wrapper for the service.
Okay, quite brave, I'd say. Well, but JQ is quite a quite stable project now. Like the errors you saw were probably because I used an audited version here. But yeah, like the function I was trying to show before for translating human readable names of colors to ANSI codes. Like I used this in the log file processor to output nicely colored log files. And the usage of this function was like here, the example. We can pass it some words describing the color we want. Like for example, here we want bold green. And it would output the sequence which causes ANSI terminals to make the text bright green usually. So like using this more advanced stuff in JQ, you can process like any text files or JSON files and I think it can be more handy than using Python or Perl sometimes. Like Python is quite slow for large for processing large log files. Okay. Any more questions?
Yeah, two questions. Like you don't have to show answers of my question just there. Mm-hmm. Simple answers. So the first question is order of the execution. Like mm-hmm. if I have a couple methods and I want mm-hmm. to run them in certain order, so is the script going to be run from top down or I have to build some kind of main method to kick them off in the order that I want? That's the question. And the second question is that does it support string? Can you do some operation on the fly, or?
Yeah, those are very good questions. So I will start with the second one because it's easier. So I was going to mention that, but I forgot, of course. So there is the streaming mode, which I probably forgot to mention because this version doesn't support it. Yeah, but. There is a streaming mode which just here. Okay. -- stream. Okay, maybe on JQ. Okay, yeah. So it doesn't list all the it doesn't list all the options. So yeah, there's a streaming mode. So in streaming mode, JQ takes each like JSON text on the input and it processes it immediately without waiting to read the whole file until the end. And because of that, it also outputs some additional info like. Position of the element in the stream and so on. So this is a bit more advanced, and it's described in the manual, and it's a bit confusing maybe.
One comment. So there are two things here. So you have this, which is a stream parsing. So you can put a big JSON file into a stream way parse the file, but also you can output new documents one by one to the standard input of JQ, and it will process them one by one, like as a stream. So if you have something that produces a stream to standard output, you can pipe to JQ and it will not wait for the whole output.
For the whole bunch, yeah.
It works as a stream by design.
And as for the first question, about the scripts. So, so JQ only expects a single expression as the main code to run. So, you don't like run several. It's not that like in imperative programming where you just run some functions and they do something, because all functions in JQ are referentially transparent. They don't have side effects. Like, it's not strictly true, because I think there are some extensions which can do that, but let's not go there. Yeah, there are a few functions which can do some side effects, but that's very rare. So usually you have just one expression which takes some input and produces some output, and you use the pipe operator to combine the stages.
But if I want to do some JSON processing, so I can write some my methods, stuff like that, and save in the kind of script file which I can run later on. Or
You can, like,
for example, like this file, and can I add more methods, like another method, like, you know, path write something, and like five methods in this script file. So, and I'm just wondering if I wanna execute this file, the which function will be run first. And which one will be the last one? So it's gonna be like top down, or I have to do some extra.
Okay, so JQ script JQ. Let's define something else, like foo plus one. So let's put this times two, four. Okay, so here we have, let's delete this. So here we have a file which contains some function definition and some program, let's say. So we can run it like this, script JQ, no, at line one, column four. Because I'm passing it as the JSON file instead of that's what was wrong before. Instead of passing the script to JQ as a script, I was passing it as the JSON input. Sorry, I knew something would go horribly wrong, but I wanted to try it anyway. So yeah, file name, script JQ, and let's input some. So as you can see, it runs the script, which doubles the value which we input, and then increments it by one using the function. So now, if you have more functions, minus one, let's say, it will. So if we have more functions, I forgot semicolon. It will just run them in. Oh, I realized it's a bit small. So it runs them in the order in which you put them, like in the body. So it doesn't run these definitions themselves. Like, it reads them and it defines the functions, and you cannot use a function before it's defined. And they also have lexical scoping, which means that if you have like if you define a function within another function, the inner function will only be available in the in this function in which you defined it. So let's say here, if we define foo inner here, and now let's call foo inner. Like if we do this, then foo inner will be available only inside foo, and it won't be available anywhere else. So if you use it here, for example, it won't work. It will throw another error. So
it's fine from here.
So the order is defined by your code. Like you cannot define multiple expressions here, because JQ only expects one expression, which takes some input and produces some output, and you know it's like a function which takes one input and one output, like the whole program. Because everything in JQ is a filter, except the values, of course. Yeah. Okay. So any more questions?
Yeah. So when you define a script, mm-hmm. Inline in the console,
yeah,
you define everything in single quotes.
Yeah. That's to avoid bash interpreting the dollar signs and.
My question is, I want to include them in the output, like in our.
That's a bash thing, like.
I can escape them somehow.
So, like here I'm using bash, so it supports something called here documents. So. Let's say you want to so let's define a script foo plus one and a semicolon, I forgot, and now let's multiply it by two and filter it through foo of end of file, and because it expected
I think it tries to treat it as a JSON.
Oh yeah, that's right. Of course. So so if I wanted to do this inline, I would have to do it like this, probably, and I would have to add cut here. Like it's not very feasible if you want to.
Like you can always use the awkward way, so you terminate a single quote, start a double quote.
You could do it like, let's say you want to put each element through to string, and now we want to append some string. That's not a good example because we have double quotes here. So we want to add a single quote here. So it doesn't work because bash thinks it's single quote between O's is terminates the string. So if we want to do that, that's a good suggestion. We can terminate the bash string, then use double quotes to escape the single quote, and then open the string again, but that's quite awkward. You could also use double quotes here, but then you would have to remember that dollar sign means variable substitution in bash, so you would have to escape each dollar sign. So So yeah, but that's a bash thing. Like I didn't want to talk about bash. I'm sure there are some shells which do it differently, so maybe it would be easier in those shells. But yeah, this was mainly about like if you have some one-liners, then you probably they don't contain apostrophes. And if you have some more complex scripts, you probably want to define them in a file and pass them to JQ using the minus F option, which I failed to do twice at least today. Yeah. Anything else?
I have a proposition to ask the question during the break, because you have E also and it's cold. mm-hmm. So, yes? Is it okay for you?
Yeah, sure. I would love a break because...